Hello friends, welcome to a new lecture today on stomach MCQs. So question number 1. All are true about Dulaifois lesion except. So first, Dulaifois lesion is presence of dilated tortuous artery leading into submucosa. So here angiographic embolization is the preferred treatment. True. Because it is submucosal tortuous artery which is present, so angiographic embolization is a preferred treatment. Angiographic embolization can be done, but it is not the first line. The first line treatment is endoscopic treatment. Then, in Dulaifois lesion, pulsation of artery causes ulceration. True. It is a submucosal artery. It is true. See, Dulaifois lesion can be diagnosed most commonly by endoscopy. So, the diagnosis is through endoscopy. So, once you diagnose the lesion, you will inject endoscopic sclerosant or you can do thermal therapy endoscopically. Is right. This endoscopic sclerosant injection or thermal therapy is 100%, 80 to 100% successful rate. But if this fails, in a few cases it might fail. If it fails, then you do angiographic embolization. Angiographic embolization is done, but it is not the preferred treatment. The preferred treatment is endoscopic sclerosant injection or giving thermal therapy is the preferred treatment for Dulaifois lesion. Then question number 2. All are true about Dulaifois lesion except submucosal tortuous artery. Yes, Dulaifois lesion is a submucosal tortuous artery. Mucosal erosion by arterial pulsation. True. Amenable to endoscopic treatment. True. It is first line is endoscopic treatment. Angiographic embolization is preferred treatment. It is false. Actually, angiographic embolization is second line management. If it cannot be decreased or it cannot be resolved by endoscopic treatment. Then question number 3. All are true about GAVE is. See, what is this GAVE? GAVE is the gastric antral vascular ectasia, where you see dilated mucosal blood vessel in lamina propria. Sometimes that mucosal blood vessel might contain thrombi. So what are the true statements? It is dilated submucosal venous plexus. True. Bleeding is the most common presentation because it is gastric antral vascular ectasia. It is true. Bleeding is the most common presentation. Then third, pain is the most common symptom. True. Pain is not the most common symptom. Bleeding is the most common presentation and bleeding is the most common symptom, not the pain. Organ laser treatment is established one. True, you should do endoscopic organ plasma laser coagulation is the treatment of choice. Endoscopic organ plasma laser coagulation is the treatment of choice. Most common site for this gastric antral vascular ectasia is antrum, as the name says. The most common symptom is bleeding. Chronic bleeding, which can predispose to anemia, most commonly seen in elderly women. Then, question number 4. Mantrier's disease is characterized by all except. First, Mantrier's disease has excessive protein loss. True. That is one of the characteristic features of Mantrier's disease is excessive protein loss. Excessive mucus production. True. Because of foveolar hyperplasia, There is excessive mucus production. Diarrhea. Yes, diarrhea can be seen. And hyperchlorhydria. Hyperchlorhydria is false. Actually, there is hypochlorhydria. In Mentrier's disease, there is foveolar hyperplasia and parietal cell atrophy. Because of atrophy of parietal cells, normally parietal cells produces HCl, hydrochloric acid, which contributes to acidic pH. But if parietal cells are atrophied, then there is no production of acid. So there is no chloride ions. So there won't be hyperchlorhydria, there is hypochlorhydria. Then question number 5. All are true about Mentrier's disease except protein loss, true. It is not hyperchlorhydria, it is hypochlorhydria. Cobblestone appearance of mucosa, true, because of excessive, you know, hypertrophy and cerebriform, excessive mucosal folds, you have cobblestone appearance of mucosa. Mentrier's disease is sometimes associated with cytomegalovirus, especially in children, and H. pylori in adults. So this is true. Then question number 6. All are true about Mentrier's disease except, right, Mentrier's disease has excessive protein loss, true. Decreased mucus production, no, in Mentrier's disease, you see, increased mucus production. Acquired pre-malignant condition, yes, it is an acquired condition and it can predispose to malignancy. H. pylori is a predisposing factor in adults. True, H. pylori is predisposing factor in adult, whereas cytomegalovirus is the predisposing factor in children. Histology shows foveolar hyperplasia and absence of parietal cells. You see massive gastric folds appearing like brain is seen in fundus and body of stomach. Then question number 7. Due to popularity of refrigeration, reducing the need to preserve the food, which cancer's incidence has dramatically declined? It is stomach cancer's incidence has dramatically declined. Actually, with refrigeration. So, actually, for preserving foods, we used to add nitrate salts or salt, excessive salt addition to foods has been practiced in older days to preserve food. But right now, because of the availability of refrigeration, we do not add lots of salts or nitrates to preserve food. Excessive salted food or high nitrate food can predispose to stomach carcinoma. So because of this refrigeration, the stomach carcinoma has been declined. Then question number 7. Gastric carcinoma is associated with the blood group A. Gastric carcinoma is associated with blood group A. Then question number 8. Risk factors for development of gastric carcinoma is blood group O. No, actually blood group A is a risk factor for gastric carcinoma. Duodenal ulcer. Remember, duodenal ulcer is not a pre-malignant condition. It does not predispose to malignancy. Gastric ulcer, on the other hand, gastric ulcer is a pre-malignant condition. But it only 0.1 to 1% of gastric ulcers develop or progress into gastric carcinoma. Duodenal ulcers do not have any contribution to carcinoma stomach. Intestinal hyperplasia does not cause carcinoma, but intestinal metaplasia definitely is a pre-malignant or risk factor for gastric carcinoma. Which of the following is the most significant risk factor for developing gastric carcinoma. Among all these, intestinal metaplasia is the most common risk factor for developing gastric carcinoma. Then the last question for today's class, all of the following predispose to gastric carcinoma except, see, achlorhydria predisposes to gastric carcinoma. Pernicious anemia and post-gastrectomy predisposes to gastric carcinoma, but blood group A, A predisposes to gastric carcinoma, not blood group O. So, thank you guys for watching my lecture. Thank you.